Hello guys, in this video we are going to see about hypothesis testing. A hypothesis testing is generally used to answer a question or an assumption on a population using sample data. So the following steps has to be performed before conducting the hypothesis test. So the first step is you have to state the research question. So let's take an example. Let's consider a data set which has features named age. The data set has details of elderly people who have taken memory training and who haven't taken memory training and their corresponding memory test scores. So here group is equal to 1 indicates the people have taken the memory test, and group is equal to 2 indicates the people haven't taken the memory test. So for this data set I have taken the research question as, does memory training improve the test score? So the data set we have the people who have taken memory training as well as the people who haven't taken memory training, right? So we just want to find whether memory training have any impact on the test score. So the second step of hypothesis testing is we have to state null as well as alternate hypothesis. So for this research question, so my null hypothesis, which will be generally indicated as H0, will be there is no improvement in the test score. So let me consider mu 1 as the mean of the people who have taken the test memory training, and let mu 2 be the people who have mean of the people who haven't taken the memory training. So according to null hypothesis, there is no difference in the mean of people who have taken the memory test and who haven't taken the memory test. So I can state it as mu 1 minus mu 2 is equal to 0, or mu 1 is equal to mu 2. So this will be my null hypothesis. So similarly, I have to frame an alternate hypothesis, which is denoted as HA. So alternate hypothesis will be opposite to that of null hypothesis. So in this problem statement, my alternate hypothesis will be, so mu 1 is greater than mu 2. That is, people who have taken the memory test is having better test score when compared to the people who haven't taken the memory test score. So mean of the people who have taken the memory test is greater than the mean of the people who haven't taken the memory test. Or this can be written as mu 1 minus mu 2 should be greater than 0. So this is my alternate hypothesis. So the third step is we have to select a value for significance level. So most probably this alpha will be taken as 0.05. So once the significance level is set, we have to collect the data. Okay, so for the problem statement which we have used, or for the research question which we have selected, we have to collect appropriate data. In order to prove the hypothesis, we have to collect the data. So once the data is collected, we have to perform the test statistic. Either you can perform t-test, or you can perform ANOVA test, or you can perform chi-square test. So any of this test can be performed, and as the result of this test we have to calculate a p-value. So we will come to the conclusion based on the p-value. We will make a decision on rejecting or accepting the null hypothesis based on the p-value. So once the p-value is calculated, so if p-value is less than or equal to 0.05, we will reject the null hypothesis. So reject H0. If p-value is greater than 0.05, the null hypothesis can be accepted. So accept H0, or you can reject alternate hypothesis. So once this is done, based on the p-value, we can answer the research question. So in this scenario, in this example, if we have obtained the p-value less than or equal to 0.05, we can come to a conclusion that there is no, so for this problem statement, if p-value is less than or equal to 0.05, we can reject the null hypothesis, which means the memory training improves the test scores, right? Mu 1 is greater than mu 2. So if p-value is greater than 0.05, we can accept the null hypothesis. The meaning is there is no impact of memory training. So those who have taken the memory training and those who haven't taken the memory training, so memory training doesn't improve the test score. So these are the steps which has to be followed while performing the hypothesis test. Let's now discuss about the various statistical tests. Let's discuss about the t-test. So t-test is a statistical hypothesis test, and generally one sample t test for paired samples, and independent two sample t test are used. So whenever we want to compare the mean of a single group against a known mean, we will go for one sample t test. So the test statistic in one sample t test is t is equal to x minus mu naught into s by root n. So here x is nothing but the sample mean, s is nothing but the sample standard deviation, and n is the sample size. Let's consider an example. So let's consider a company producing cookies. So each cookie produced by this company is supposed to contain 10 grams of sugar. So this sugar is added by a machine before mixing everything in a bowl. So you believe that the machine doesn't add 10 grams of sugar for each cookie. So if this assumption is true, the machine needs to be fixed. So you are considering a sample of 30 cookies. So in this example, my null hypothesis will be, the null hypothesis is nothing but average level of sugar is equal to 10. So my mu value is equal to 10 is the null hypothesis, whereas the alternate hypothesis is the average value of sugar is not equal to 10, is different than 10. It can be greater than 10 or it can be less than 10. So these are my null hypothesis as well as alternate hypothesis. So I have to check these assumptions with the help of hypothesis testing. So here the mean value is a known value. We need to compare the mean with respect to a known mean value. That's why we are going for one sample t-test. So now let's see the implementation of this example in our programming. So first let's create the data for the hypothesis testing. So I'm going to use a function named rnormof. So rnormof is used to provide the normally distributed data. So I need 30 observations. So the parameters to be passed for rnorm functions are the number of observations as well as mean value. Let me randomly give the mean value as 30 and standard deviation. So let me give the standard deviation value as 0.04. So I am saving it as a variable named cookie. So cookie is equal to rnorm of 30, 10, 0.04. So let me run this. Let me print the head of this cookie. Or let me print this cookie. You can find the normally distributed data generated. So this data will be having the mean value 10 and standard deviation 0.04. So in case if I execute this again, I can find different values, right? So since it is randomly generated, so each time I execute this code, I will be getting different values, different random values will be obtained. So if I want to get the same values each time whenever I execute this, so I have to pass a variable named set dot seed of, you can give any value. So within this set dot seed of, you can pass any values. So for the time being, I am giving the value as 1, 2, 3. So now if I execute this even several times, I will be getting the same result. Okay, you can see, right? So each time I'm getting the same result. So whenever you are creating some random values, and if you need the same values to be repeated each time, you can make use of this set dot seed of. So now my data has been generated. So I want to perform one sample t test. So a function used for performing the one sample t test is t dot test of. So t dot test of mention the data for which we have to perform the t test and the mu value. Here we are comparing the mu with respect to the fixed mu value, right? Fixed mean value 10. So let me execute this. Okay, so we got the result, right? So we got the degrees of freedom p value. So p value you can find, which is 0.794, which is greater than 0.05. So since the p value is greater than 0.05, we can accept the null hypothesis, right? So we can come to a conclusion that the
average sugar level is nothing but 10. So here you can find the 95 percentile confidence interval is 9.98 and 10, with sugar value in between 9.98 and 10 grams. So since the p-value is greater than 0.05, we can accept the null hypothesis.
Now let's see about the t-test for paired samples. So it is generally used for comparing the means from the same group at different times. Now the company is checking that whether there is any improvement in the sales after sales campaign. So the data is collected before sales campaign as well as after sales campaign. So your null hypothesis can be there is no difference in the sales before and after sales campaign. Your alternate hypothesis is nothing but there is a difference in the sales before and after sales campaign. So in such scenario, you can make use of this t-test for paired samples. So the test statistic is t is equal to d minus mu naught sd by q of n, where d is the average and sd is the standard deviation of the differences. Now let's see the implementation of this example in our program.
First, let's generate the data for performing the hypothesis testing. So here we need the data of sales before the sales campaign program as well as after the sales campaign program. So sales before the program and after the program. So the same R0 function I am going to use for generating the normal distributed data. So let me name the variable as sales underscore before and use the rnorm function. So rnorm of, I'm going to consider 7 observations, 7 samples. So 7 comma, let me give the mean value as 50,000 and standard deviation as 50. So you can give any value for mean and standard deviation. Even you can generate the distributed data without giving the mean and standard deviation value. So let me print the variable sales underscore before. So you can see 7 observations have been generated. So next let me create another variable named sales underscore after. So let me use the same rnorm function. So I need 7 observations and I'm giving the mean value as 5075 and standard deviation is 50. Let me print the sales after data. So this is the sales after data. So now the data has been generated. Now I can apply the t-test for paired samples. So the syntax used for this is same as that of t-test, one sample t-test. So t dot test, I have to pass this to variables sales underscore before as well as sales underscore after. So here I am going to consider the variance for each group or equal. So if the variance is equal, you can pass this parameter var dot equal is equal to true. In case if the variance is not equal, you do not want to pass this parameter. Okay, so let me execute this. So now I got the values, right? So here p value is less than 0.05. So here my null hypothesis has been rejected, right? The meaning is there is difference in the sales before and after sales campaign. Okay, so the 95 percentile confidence interval values lies between minus 45.088 and minus 44.993. So since p value is less than 0.05, then null hypothesis has been rejected in this example.
Whenever we want to compare the means of two different groups, we can make use of this independent two sample t-test. T is equal to, the test statistics used here is t is equal to x1 bar minus x2 bar by S del bar. So S del bar is nothing but root of S1 square by N1 plus S2 square by N2, where S21 and S22 are the unbiased estimators of the variances of two samples and N suffix K indicates the number of participants in group k equal to 1 or 2. Now let's perform the hypothesis testing for a sample data set named active. It's a CSV file. So let's see the implementation in R. So let me import the data and read it as a data frame. So I'm naming my data frame as A. So it's a CSV file. So let me use the function read.csv of, and the name of my data frame data set is active. So active.csv. Let me print the head of my data frame. So my data frame is having various features named site, age, education, group, booster, gender, recent, UFOV, HVLTT, HVLTT2, HVLTT3, HVLTT4, MMSE, ID. So this is nothing but a data set of an elderly people, which has been collected at 6 different sites. So some kind of training has been given for all these elderly people. So here group, so totally there are 6 different sites. It indicates the different sites at which the data has been collected. EDU indicates the years of education, and this group indicates there are 3 different groups. So group is equal to 1 indicates memory training has been given for those people. Group is equal to 2 indicates reasoning training has been given. Group is equal to 3 indicates speed training has given, and group is equal to 4 indicates the training has not been given, control group. So the information of elderly people for whom different kind of training is given. So based on this training given, the scores has been calculated. So HVLTT indicates Hopkins Verbal Learning Test score at time 1. So 2 indicates at time 2 what is the score. 3 indicates at time 3 what is the score obtained. 4 indicates that at time 4 what is the score obtained. So gender is equal to 1 indicates male, and gender is equal to 2 indicates female. Reason is nothing but the reasoning ability. MMSE in the sense mini mental state examination total score. So the total score is listed here. So this is the description about the data. So now using this data, we want to check the following hypothesis. So our first hypothesis testing is nothing but we are checking, does memory training improve participants' performance on a memory test? For this hypothesis testing, my null hypothesis is nothing but there is no improvement in the memory test. There is no difference in the mean between the participants, those who have taken the memory training and those who haven't taken the memory training. So H naught will be mu 1 equal to mu 2. My alternate hypothesis will be there is difference in the mean between the people who have taken the memory training and who haven't taken the memory training. So mu 1 will be greater than mu 2. Now let's see the implementation in R programming. So before moving on, let me check the null values of the data. So sum of is dot na of a. So my data is not having any null value. Let me print the summary of the data. So I can find the statistical description of each features. The minimum value, the first quartile, median, mean, third quartile, and maximum value of each numerical features can be obtained here. So now let's move on to the first subdivision. So which is nothing but we are checking whether memory training improve the participants' performance on a memory test. For implementing this hypothesis testing, we need the data. So we need the data of the test score of people who belong to group 1. So group 1 indicates the people who have taken memory training, and group 4 indicates the people who haven't taken memory training. So we want to get the score. So HVLTT2. So this is the test score, memory test score. So we want to
get the memory test score for people who belong to group 1 as well as people who belong to group 4. So I can use the subsetting. So let me name my first variable as training. So training is equal to subset of the data followed by the condition. So here my first condition is my group should be equal to 1. So those who have obtained the memory training belongs to group 1, comma, I need the data of HVLTT2. So let me print this data training. So you can find the details of the people who belong to group 1 and their training score. So test score has been obtained. So similarly, let me obtain the test score of the people who haven't taken the memory test. I am naming this as control. So let me apply the subset function. So subset of A is equal to group 4. So group 4 is the people who haven't taken the memory test. So let me print the data control. So you can find the details of the people who belong to group 2 and their test score. So once this is done, you can directly apply the t-test. So the function used for performing the test is t.test. So t.test and pass the two variables, training and control. Okay. So we want to pass an additional parameter named alternative. So alternative in the sense, the alternative hypothesis, whether the mean of the first group is greater than the mean of second group or it is less than the mean of the second group. Okay, so here in this example, we have framed our alternative hypothesis as the test value of the first group, the people who have taken training, is greater than the test score of the people who haven't taken the memory training. So in alternative, we have to give the option as greater. So in case if we have framed the alternative hypothesis as lesser value, in place of this greater, you have to pass the function parameter as lesser. So once this is done, let me execute this. So it will return the value. So here you can find the value of p value is equal to 2.87 exponential of minus 7, which is nothing but less than 0.05. So since here the p value is less than 0.05, we can come to a conclusion, we can reject the null hypothesis. The meaning is the memory training improves the participants' performance. So the test score of the people who have taken the memory training is greater than the test score of the people who haven't taken the memory training. So that's the conclusion we can come from this. So now let's check the second subdivision, which is nothing but, is there any difference in the score between the first time and last time of verbal test? So next hypothesis testing is, we just want to find, is there any difference in the score between the first time and last time of verbal test. So we have to do the t-test for paired samples. So here we want to compare the mean from the same group at different times. You can find, so HVLTT, HVLT2, T3, T4 or the test score taken at different times. So we want to compare whether there is any difference in the score between HVLTT and HVLTT4. Here our null hypothesis will be there is no difference in the score, and the alternate hypothesis will be there is difference in the score. So let's use the function t.test of, pass the two parameters HVLTT and HVLTT4. So whenever you are performing the t-test for paired samples, you want to pass an additional parameter named paired is equal to true. So that's the only difference. So let me execute this. So you can obtain the values. So B value is equal to 0.104. So which is greater than 0.05. So since the P value is greater than 0.05, you can accept the null hypothesis. So the meaning is there is no difference between the score between the first time and last time of the verbal test. So the next hypothesis testing is we want to check whether the education level of people is above high school. So years of education is greater than 12. So we have the age group of the people as well as the education level of different people, right? So we now need to check whether there is the education level is above high school. So here we need to use one sample t-test. A fixed mu value is given. So mu value is equal to 12. We want to check whether mu is equal to 12 or mu value is greater than 12. So our null hypothesis will be mu value is equal to 12 and our alternate hypothesis will be mu value is greater than 12. So let's use the function t dot test of. So here we are going to use the feature education edu. So edu and we have to pass the mu value. So for performing the one sample t test, we want to pass the data as well as the fixed mu value. So here the mu value given is 12, as well as we have to give the parameter alternative. So here our alternative is nothing but our alternative hypothesis says that the education level of people is greater than 12. So here I have to pass the parameter for alternative as greater. So we have obtained the p-value which is less than 0.05. So since the p-value is less than 0.05, we can reject the null hypothesis. So the meaning is the education level of the people is above high school or years of education is greater than 12. So since p-value is greater than less than 0.05, we are accepting the alternate hypothesis. So that's all. Thank you.